A couple of weeks ago, I uploaded a video about the double-slit experiment. The purpose of this video was to capture some of the excitement that comes with learning about a new physics idea for the first time. For this reason, I chose to use the Dr. Quantum double-slit explainer video and got some of my friends to react to it. I chose this video because it was reasonably short and explained some of the aspects of the double-slit experiment in a reasonably engaging and fun way. But that video isn't perfect, and especially since the video of mine got more views than I really anticipated it to, I feel like I want to clarify a few things. When I first saw that Dr. Quantum video, I was in high school and I didn't know anything about physics. Despite some of its flaws, which I'm going to discuss in this video, I found that it was one of the things that gave me enough interest in physics to actually go on and do a physics major. It was a source of intrigue and curiosity for me, and I hoped that that is what it would also be for some of my audience members. I'll put some links in the description for you to pursue some of these ideas more, but let's talk about some of the flaws of the video. The main problem with the Dr. Quantum video, as pointed out by many of you in the comments, comes when it starts to discuss using a detector to determine which of two slits a particle goes through, as it appeared to be going through both slits and interacting with itself to create an interference pattern. When the detector is used, the particle goes back to behaving classically. It only goes through one slit and the interference pattern on the wall is lost. This is called a which-way experiment. In the Dr. Quantum video, they use an eye to represent the detector, and they say it is as if the particle knows it is being watched. But this is a bit misleading because in reality, the detector is measuring the particle, and this measurement is interacting with the particle. It is this interaction that causes the interference pattern to be lost. A quantum particle moves as a wave of probabilities of being in any location. Its exact location is unknown, and if you were to measure its exact location, you would collapse the wave function. This would also cause you to lose the interference pattern, which is caused by the wave-like nature of the quantum particle. Here is a clip of Neil deGrasse Tyson talking to Joe Rogan about this idea.
So, I'm looking at you. The only reason why I can see you is because there's light reflecting off of your face, your body, into my eyes. I want to know where you are. So I turn on the lights and I say, there you are. All right. Now, let's make you tinier. Let's make you mini me, okay, like in the movie.
Right.
So now it's a tiny version of you, a mini me version of Joe Rogan. Now you're little. I turn on the lights. You're still there. Okay.
Okay.
Because if the lights are not on, I can't see you. I don't know where you are.
Right.
It's that simple.
Okay.
Okay? When you start becoming the size of molecules, right on down to the size of an atom, and I ask the question, where is Joe Rogan the atom? And I turn on the light to see you there, because I think you're there. The light, the photon comes in, hits your atom, and pops you into another location.
Mm.
The very act of trying to measure your position prevents me from measuring your position. And it has to have jack shit to do with your consciousness, or your mind, or your eyes, or anything. It has to do with the fact that to know you're there, some information has to come from you to me. Like shining a light on you. And the smaller you are, the more susceptible you are to the energy of the light changing your position in space. And to the point where that's actually, it's the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It's one of the basic foundations of all of quantum physics.
Methods to detect the particle could also include putting a polarizing filter over one of the slits or a thin layer of material, which would change the way that the wave propagates. These methods affect the coherence of the wave and would also lead to the loss of the interference pattern. When discussing the idea of trying to figure out which slit the particle goes through, people are often actually talking about a delayed choice experiment or the quantum eraser. In a delayed choice experiment, a detector is placed after the slits, and this seems to retroactively affect how the particles were behaving when they went through the slits. PBS Spacetime has a really good video on this, which I'll link down below. What's most important is that the interference pattern is lost when information about which path the particle has taken becomes available to the external environment. It doesn't matter if this information ends up in the brain of a human, the brain of a frog, is seen by a pot plant, or just leaks out into stray air molecules. A conscious observer is not a necessary part of the process. For a good argument on why a conscious observer is not required, please read the article Quantum Mechanics Needs No Consciousness. In this article, they talk about experiments where which way information about the path that a particle took is measured, but not on a macroscopic device, so not available for a conscious observer to read. The information was stored in the state of a single atom, and under these conditions, the interference pattern was still lost, meaning that a conscious observer was not required to cause collapse of the wave function. I have seen claims that quantum mechanics is vital to understanding consciousness, but I think that having these two mysteries disentangled from each other is an important step in being able to understand both of them a bit better. This is my current understanding of the experiment based on the information that I've read about it. If you think anything else needs further clarification, please post a comment about it. There were some really thoughtful and helpful comments in the comment section of my last video, but there was also some hostility towards people with alternative viewpoints. I would rather they feel like they can say their misconceptions and have them corrected in sort of a kind manner, rather than feeling like there is a lot of hostility towards them. There were also some comments that kind of surprised me, from people saying things like, "Oh, how could anyone not know about the double slit experiment? I learned about this as a child," and sort of insinuating that anyone who hadn't learned about it was somehow below them. To that, I say that, you know, if you don't have friends from a range of different education backgrounds and interests, then that's not something to be proud of. I don't consider someone knowing about the double slit experiment to be a criteria for them to become my friend or for me to talk to them. In fact, I really enjoy talking to people from, you know, a whole variety of interests. Don't hate on people who are willing to learn new things just because they're not at your level. I think it can be somewhat easy to get trapped in a bubble where all your friends are sort of at the same level as you, they know the same things and have similar interests, and you can gain a warped perception of what general knowledge really is and what general people are concerned about and know about. I think though that possibly that should be something you want to go out of your way to try and correct, to talk to more people who have different interests from you and to try and broaden your own knowledge and understanding. Thanks for watching this video. Thanks to everyone who did leave really insightful comments on my last one, and I'll see you next time.